So it's necessary for us to take a look at these things and to decide for ourselves what we think we ought to do. And if we need some help or advice from people who've been there before, for goodness sakes, we get it. But it's talking about writing a whole chapter on a manic depressive. Now, manic depressive in those days was an identifiable disease, which was the symptoms of which were extreme agitation and mania on the one end of the scale, followed by a deep depression on the other side. And this cycle apparently is normal with all people, but in the psychopathic manic depressive, it's exaggerated, so that in the mania phase, they're very dangerous. In a depression stage, they're dangerous to themselves and dangerous. They could very easily lapse into some kind of a depression from which they would not recover. That's what it used to be. I don't know. This bipolar stuff seems way too facile for me. Anyway, there's something to think about and something to consult with. You might want to consult with a family doctor. You might want to consult with somebody who's been there before you, who's already been through this, and see what their experience was. Going on, then there are types entirely normal in every respect, except in the effect alcohol has upon them. They are often able, intelligent, friendly people. And you know, there are a lot of us around like that. A lot of you folks would fit that category precisely. There isn't, you know, you dig around back there and you can't find all that much mess in your life. You did a lot of stuff really well, but somehow or another, alcohol has you by the throat. One of the things I've known and learned in here is that alcoholics, by and large, are pretty smart. There's a high degree of intelligence and a great deal of intuitive ability with alcoholics. I don't know whether that's necessary, but it seems to be typical. And so sometimes I think we're way too smart for our own good, and we like to try to figure things out rather than follow directions. And sometimes we're better off just following directions and doing what the people before us did. They recovered, now we can recover. And by the way, there is a complete description of these various types of alcoholics and the progression of the disease in the chapter to wives, beginning on page 108. Okay, all these and many others have one symptom in common. Listen to this, they cannot start drinking without developing the phenomenon of craving. This phenomenon, as we have suggested, may be the manifestation of an allergy which differentiates these people and sets them apart as a distinct entity. It has never been, by any treatment with which we are familiar, permanently eradicated. The only relief we have to suggest is entire abstinence. Can you see the doctor just putting his hands up and saying, I surrender? We've tried this. We've tried everything we know. We've tried hot baths and cold baths. We've tried belladonna poisoning. We've tried conditioning and Pavlovian theory. We've tried psychiatry. We've tried group therapy. We've tried encounter groups. We've tried all this stuff. We've tried psychometrics. We've even called in the acupuncturists and the hypnotists, and once in a while a psychic to try to find some way to help these people, but nothing works. And we give up. What's he say again? The only relief we have to suggest is entire absence. Now this business of absence, you know, is pretty unusual, actually. We think of it as being common because we're in AA. But for most people, the idea of having to be totally abstinent just doesn't occur to them. What they're really thinking is, well, you just ought to cut back. I mean, lots of people drink here and there. They have a drink and might leave half one on the table. They get a little tiny buzz and they feel good and they get a little bit garrulous and they tell funny jokes and stuff. We ought to be able to do that too. Why do we over-drink? That was what I was my one and only wife, thank you, God.